Good afternoon. I'm Marvin Ellison, the Director of Alumni Relations. I want to welcome you to this session. As you know, the theme for Union Days this year is Why We Still Can't Wait, Race Matters, Earth Matters. I regret that our first plenary speaker, Dr. Robert Jones from Public Religion Research Institute, has suffered a knee injury, has had to have emergency surgery, and has not been able to travel. Then, alas, Dr. Marilyn Kaiser, a member of the class of 1965, also suffered an injury and is unable to travel, so we've had to cancel her organ concert that was originally scheduled for this evening. So, as you might imagine, I've been very tempted during this past week to telephone my colleague and friend Kelly Douglas to warn her to step very carefully and avoid any and all falls. But God is merciful, and so she's with us today, and all is good. Kelly Brown Douglas is the Elizabeth Connolly Todd Distinguished Professor of Religion at Goucher College and also Director of Goucher's Religion Program. For those who know her scholarship and the power of her theological voice in the classroom, in the pulpit, and through her many writings, it will be no surprise to learn that Goucher College recently honored her for an outstanding faculty achievement. Prior to joining the Goucher faculty, Dr. Brown taught first at Edward Waters College and then Howard University School of Divinity. She holds a bachelor's degree in psychology from Denison University, where she was inducted into Phi Beta Kappa and graduated summa cum laude. On behalf of this Union Days audience, let me say how delighted we are to welcome home one of our own. She received her Master's of Divinity degree from Union in 1982 and then the Doctorate of Philosophy in 1988. 2 years ago, Union recognized her with the UNITAS Distinguished Alumna Award. Kelly is also a priest in the Episcopal Church and served as associate priest at Holy Comforter Episcopal Church in Washington, D.C. for over 20 years. A leading voice in the development of womanist theology, Essence Magazine, interesting theological resource, counts her among, quote, this country's most distinguished religious thinkers, teachers, ministers, and counselors. They got that right. A widely published author, her books include The Black Christ, Sexuality and the Black Church, What's Faith Got to Do with It, Black Bodies, Christian Souls, and Black Bodies and the Black Church, A Blues Slant. I also had the pleasure of co-editing with Kelly the second edition of Sexuality and the Sacred, Sources for Theological Reflection. Her most recent book, published by Orbis Books in May of this year, is entitled Stand Your Ground, Black Bodies and the Justice of God. A book in which, with her characteristic brilliance and passion for justice, she reflects on the killings of Trayvon Martin and others from her vantage point, both as a theologian and as the mother of a young black man. We're delighted Kelly is with us today and again tomorrow morning. Her topic this afternoon is Stand Your Ground, American Exceptionalism, Black Bodies. Let us please welcome Kelly Brown Douglas.
Thank you. Thank you very much. It is an honor and a privilege to be back home, to be here back in James Chapel at Union, where if it weren't for the professors here at Union, such as my mentor and friend, Dr. James Cohn, I would not be standing here today. And it was here at Union that I was able to get the kind of support to help me find my voice. And I must say, Dr. Cohn saw something in me that I didn't see in myself. And so it is with much appreciation and gratitude that I am here and that I come to Union with. I also am so glad to be here with my friend and colleague, the president of Union, Dr. Serene Jones, who I appreciate for keeping Union the great steward you have been over this place that is home. And what a treat to see my friend and colleague, Dr. Andrea White, and to say welcome to you, to Union. And of course, my friend Marvin. Where did Marvin go to? Oh, there he is. With friends like Marvin Ellison. No, it is just when he called and asked if I would be here, what a treat. And of course, I said yes. And it's just, it's friends like Marvin that you meet at a place like Union, and they remain your friends and colleagues forever, always challenging you and always pushing you to be a better person in any moment that you find yourself living. And so I thank you, Marvin. Today I will indeed speak on this culture of stand your ground in American exceptionalism and black bodies. There was no story in the news that troubled me more at the time of its occurrence than that of Trayvon Martin's slaying. While there were others like it about which I was fully aware, such as the 2009 murder of Oscar Grant, Trayvon's murder pricked a nerve in me like none before. President Obama said that if he had a son, his son would look like Trayvon. I do have a son, and he does look like Trayvon. Raising a black child, male or female, is not an easy matter in this society. As a parent, I encourage my son to dream, to go for his dreams, and to believe in himself. At the same time, however, I have to make him aware of the society of which he is a part. This is a society where black males are perceived as suspicious or dangerous, even as black females are seen as angry and mean. As President Obama described in his July 19, 2014 press conference following the verdict in the trial of Trayvon's killer, there is virtually a visceral reaction to the black male presence, from locking car doors to clutching one's purse on an elevator. Parents of black children know the world is much more dangerous for our sons and daughters than our daughters and sons are to the world. After hearing what happened to Trayvon as he was walking home from the store wearing a hoodie and carrying iced tea and Skittles, I was once again reminded of just how dangerous a world this actually was for our children, for my son. And then, less than a year after Trayvon, there was Jordan. Then 10 months after Jordan, there was Jonathan. And then 2 months after Jonathan, there was Renisha. And then there was the July 13th, 2013 not guilty verdict of Trayvon's killer. Hurt, disbelief, anger, confusion, and fear were profound within black congregations across the United States the morning after that Saturday night verdict. In my own congregation that Sunday morning, men were literally shaken and women cried. How could they let him off the hook, people asked. Trayvon Martin is dead. Is not a black boy's life worth anything? How are we supposed to protect our children? As the reality of the verdict sank in, black church people wondered if there would ever be justice for Trayvon. They also wondered if the world would ever be a just place for their children. When the judge read the verdict, Black Americans were once again confronted with the harsh reality that Black life in America was virtually unprotected, if not dispensable. The decision regarding Trayvon's killer was the 21st century version of the 1857 Dred Scott decision that at any given moment in time, Black people have no rights that the white man is bound to respect. At some point in the life of every Black woman and man, they must face the shock, James Baldwin says, that the flag to which you have pledged allegiance, along with everybody else, has not pledged allegiance to you. It comes as a great shock, he continues, to discover that the country which is your birthplace and to which you owe your life and identity has not in its whole system of reality evolved any place for you. For many young Black women and men coming of age some 50 years after the Civil Rights era and during the time of a Black president, they are facing this shock because they come to grips with what happened to Trayvon, Jordan, Jonathan, Renisha, and then Michael, Tamir, Rakia, and the list can go on and on. Indeed, the tragic and devastating events surrounding the murder of Trayvon Martin and subsequent acquittal of his killer was a jarring reminder of the deep-seated, if not intractable, problem of race in America. It made clear, especially for those living under the illusion of a post-racial society, that the color line of the 20th century was not only still real, but it was as unyielding and as deadly as it had ever been. And so, unnerved by the deaths of the Trayvons and Renishas, scared for the life of my child, and despairing over the lethal reality of the color line, I was compelled, if not called by something deep within, to try and figure out what was going on. Something must be said, I thought, about what is happening to our Black children. 50-some years ago, in response to President Kennedy's assassination, Martin Luther King Jr. wrote, "Our nation should do a great deal of soul searching." He went on to say, "While the question who killed President Kennedy is important, the question what killed him is more important." And so, while convicting the killers of our Trayvons and Renishas is important, more important is understanding what killed them. It was in my search for answers to what was killing our children that I was led to Stand Your Ground culture. I will focus on this culture in my lecture this afternoon as we try to gain perspective on what is happening to our Black sons and daughters and insight into the deadly culture that defines the racialized reality that is America. Stand Your Ground law provided the backdrop to the Trayvon Martin case. This law is an extension of English common law that gives a person the right to protect his or her castle. Stand Your Ground essentially broadens the notion of castle to include one's body. It permits certain individuals to protect their embodied castle whenever and wherever they feel threatened. In this regard, a person does not have to retreat from the place in which he or she is castled. They can stand their ground. Essentially, a person's body is their castle. While this law was initially invoked as a reason for Trayvon's killing, it was not used as a formal defense. Nevertheless, Stand Your Ground law signals a social cultural climate that makes the destruction and death of Black bodies inevitable and even permissible. A Stand Your Ground culture has produced and sustained slavery, Black codes, Jim Crow, lynching, and other forms of racialized violence on Black bodies. This very culture also sustains the prison industrial complex, which thrives on Black bodies, male and female, as evident by the fact that Black males are 6 times more likely than white males to be incarcerated, and Black females 3 times more likely than their white counterpart. Most disturbing, as witnessed over the past 2 years or so, is that Stand Your Ground culture seems only to have intensified as it continues to take young Black lives, such as Michael Brown, Tamir Rice, John Crawford, Eric Garner, Walter Scott, Tanisha Anderson, Freddie Gray, and again, the list could go on and on. The continual slayings of innocent black bodies makes clear that there is, as King said, an urgent need for soul searching within this nation. Soul searching begins with a recognition of the grand narrative of this country, which has sustained a stand your ground culture and the religious canopies that have legitimated it. In this short space of time, I cannot begin to cover fully the complex and interlocking web of systems and ideologies that were born from stand your ground culture. I will therefore focus primarily on that aspect of this culture which has constructed the black body as a criminal body, thus rendering it always guilty of something, making aggressive and fatal violence against black bodies acceptable. The making of the criminal guilty black body begins with the arrival of the first Americans to this soil, pilgrims and Puritans alike. In 98 CE, Roman historian Tacitus published what has been called one of the most dangerous books ever written, Germania. Perhaps it is. In a brief space of 30 pages, he offered an ethnological perspective that would have tragic consequences for centuries to come. It is the racial specter behind stand your ground culture. Germania provides a meticulous portrait of an Aboriginal people, free from all taint of intermarriages, he says, with fierce blue eyes, red hair, huge frames, who possessed good moral habits, a peculiar respect for human rights, individual rights, and an almost instinctive love for freedom, says Tacitus. Tacitus' ethnological description spawned the construction of the Anglo-Saxon myth. This myth has been a ubiquitous, even if unspoken and unacknowledged, ideology in the modern world. Initially, this myth highlighted Anglo-Saxon forms of governing and stressed the unique superiority of Anglo-Saxon religious and political institutions. Eventually, and perhaps inevitably, the myth shifted its focus to Anglo-Saxon blood. In so doing, it suggested that the superiority of the institutions was a result of Anglo-Saxon blood. It argued that strong moral qualities and high regard for freedom flowed uniquely through Anglo-Saxon veins. This myth, replete with reverence for Tacitus, arrived in America by way of England's post-Reformation struggles with the Pilgrims and Puritans as they fled from the Church of England to build a nation more befitting Anglo-Saxon virtue and freedom. They considered themselves the Anglo-Saxon remnant that was continuing a divine mission. They traced this mission beyond the woods of Tacitus Germans to the Israelites in the Bible. They carried their Anglo-Saxon heritage across the Atlantic Ocean with a self-righteous pride. From its earliest beginnings, therefore, America's social-political identity with a legitimating religious canopy was an Anglo-Saxon identity. Its sense of democracy and freedom was inextricably linked to the Anglo-Saxon myth in Tacitus Germans. This was a myth that greatly shaped the father of America's democracy, Thomas Jefferson. Tacitus, I consider, is the first writer in the world without exception, wrote Jefferson to his granddaughter Anne. Jefferson's reverence for Tacitus was befitting for one as admiring of Anglo-Saxons as Jefferson. Jefferson was a thoroughgoing and unabashed Anglo-Saxonist to the point of studying Anglo-Saxon language and grammar and insisting that it should be taught in the university. What becomes clear when studying Jefferson is his Anglo-Saxon chauvinism and his strong conviction concerning the superiority of Anglo-Saxon institutions, if not people. And thus, equally as clear, is his belief in the inferiority of black people. The point of the matter is that through political architects such as Thomas Jefferson, America's democracy was conceived as an expression of Anglo-Saxon character. In his book, The Racial Contract, Charles Mills argues that America's democracy is qualified by an unspoken subaltern contract that is defined by race. He essentially argues that the liberty America promises to its citizens is only intended for white bodies. Mills' observations are apt, except for the fact that the racial limitations of America's democracy are not the result of a subaltern contract. Rather, they result from the conspicuous Anglo-Saxon chauvinism that defined America's beginnings. The city on the hill that the early Americans were building was nothing less than a testament to Anglo-Saxon chauvinism. America's exceptional identity was grounded in the Anglo-Saxon myth. Hence, the grand narrative that defines America is that of Anglo-Saxon exceptionalism. In order to sustain itself, this narrative then produced the ideology of white supremacy, what W.E.B. Du Bois describes as the wages of whiteness and legal scholar Cheryl Harris cherished white property. In this regard, whiteness is the line drawn between Anglo-Saxon exceptionalism and any other corrupting influences. It provides a protected space for America's sense of Anglo-Saxon exceptionalism. It creates a distance between its most opposing force, blackness. If people cannot pass the test of whiteness, there are certain spaces into which they cannot enter, certain rights they cannot possess, hence an exceptionality that they cannot encroach upon. Whiteness is essentially the passport into the exceptional space that is American identity, as defined by the narrative of Anglo-Saxon exceptionalism. Entrance into this space is closely and grudgingly guarded. Whiteness is therefore reified as the marker of a superior, if not exceptional, people. To reiterate, this construction of whiteness is in fact the advent of the ideology of white supremacy. Subsequently, in an effort to validate the reality of white supremacy, knowledge was willed, as Michel Foucault might say, to foster the ideology of an innate ontological difference between black people and white people. In fact, discourses were generated that cast the black body as a kind of beastly creation. Put simply, from its Puritan and Pilgrim beginnings, Anglo-Saxon power has formed an intricate web of interactive narratives and discourse to sustain itself, or to at least maintain the illusion of America's Anglo-Saxon identity. The black body has become trapped in this web that ultimately constructs it as a criminal body, always guilty of something. The black body as chattel is the specter from slavery that has the greatest impact upon black people's current social cultural realities. This construct has actually not disappeared. It was firmly established within America's collective consciousness during slavery, and it remains a pervasive part of that consciousness today. This construct is a valuable part of America's exceptionalist identity. Thus, it is not easily disposed of. Just because chattel slavery no longer exists in America, and because both the United States House of Representatives and Senate passed resolutions apologizing for it, does not mean that the racial constructs of slavery that slavery produced do not continue to exist. As Michelle Alexander has aptly pointed out, racism is highly adaptable. So too are the constructs that have fostered it. They just take different forms, those that are appropriate to the social historical context. It is what one legal scholar has called preservation through transformation. Oftentimes, the transformations effectively mask the racialized character of the new construct. Such is the case with the transformation of the black body as chattel. The 21st century version of this construct is the criminal black body. The black body that was once marked as chattel is now marked as criminal. This construct serves the same purpose as the construct of chattel. It relegates the black body to an unfree space. It preserves the free space as a white space. This transformation began shortly after emancipation. W.E.B. Du Bois says that the slave went free, stood a brief moment in the sun, and then moved again toward slavery. What Du Bois is, of course, referring to is the brief period of Reconstruction. During this period, black people began to enjoy some of the rights that were considered wages of whiteness. We know, for instance, they were able to vote and run for political office, and that black men were elected to the United States House, Senate, and the House of Representatives. However, the image of the black person of chattel, as chattel, still lurked in the imagination of American society. The fear of black people that consumed white people after emancipation was driven by the belief that black people no longer saw themselves as chattel. There was a longing, therefore, expressed for the old Negro. Essentially, there was an urgency to reinscribe black people with the identity as chattel, hence to return them to the space for which they had been allegedly created. It is, of course, not by chance that the stand your ground culture, which was fostered to protect cherished whiteness and hence the white space, began to assert itself in a more aggressive manner after emancipation, because this was the first time that white America had to deal with a population of free black bodies. Even Alexis de Tocqueville, recognized during his 19th century travels across the United States, that, as he said, the prejudice that repels Negroes seems to grow as Negroes cease to be slaves. The insertion of stand your ground culture effectively removed the black body from the white space by criminalizing it. The various assertions of Reconstruction, post-Reconstruction, stand your ground culture, such as black codes, Jim Crow laws, and lynching, served to transform the construction of chattel into criminal. Black codes and Jim Crow laws in particular helped to plant the image of the black body as a criminal body deep within America's collective consciousness. Essentially, these legal productions made a criminal of black people, so to criminalize them. This occurred through the judicious implementation of these racially biased laws. The primary target of the criminalizing project was, of course, the black male, since he was caricatured as the most dangerous free black body. He was the one that most urgently needed to be returned to the chattel space. The vagrancy laws illustrate how the black body, especially the male body, became trapped in a criminal cycle. Du Bois pays particular attention to these laws in his classic work on black Reconstruction. He calls these laws the most oppressive laws of that period, designed, he said, to fit the Negro's condition and to be enforced particularly with regard to the Negro. An example of one such law is the Georgia law. The Georgia law in part stipulated, and I read from it, all persons wandering or strolling about in idleness, who are able to work and who have no property to support them, all persons leading an idle, immoral, or profligate life, who have no property to support them and are able to work and do not work, all persons able to work having no visible and no means of a fair, honest, and respectable livelihood, shall be deemed and considered vagrants, and shall be indicted as such. Now, even though many of these vagrancy laws, like this one, did not mention race, it is clear that black people were the targets of them. The chance of a black person gaining steady employment after slavery was next to none. Again, the black body did not enjoy the right to her or his own labor. This did not significantly change after slavery, meaning, again, that they could not expect to acquire a paid job. If they managed to do so, the pay was certainly not sufficient to support them. Therefore, it is clear, as Du Bois said, that the vagrant laws were written to fit the Negro's condition. They were meant to ensnare them in a criminal cycle. Consequently, a new chattel identity was constructed. This identity was effectively transformed and reinscribed through the punishments typically meted out for vagrancy, for they involved jail time and/or some form of forced labor. Both forms of punishment literally placed the black body back into an unfree space. It removed it from the white space and returned it to the space that America's exceptionalist narrative said was suited for it. Again, an unfree space. Michelle Alexander also notes that laws such as these were clearly meant to establish another system of forced labor, that is, a new form of slavery. The criminal was literally made into chattel. Through the punishment of forced labor, they again were deprived the right of ownership to their laboring bodies. The chattel identity was subtly reconstructed as a criminal identity. It cannot be said enough. These laws literally made a criminal of black people. All the black person had to do was literally be black. Essentially, these laws penalized black people for living while black. Again, the very conditions of black living were made illegal. It is in this way that blackness became a marker for criminality. The black body is effectively criminalized. And like chattel, a criminal does not belong in the free space. Again, the construct of chattel was seamlessly transformed. Consequently, the chattel construct remains alive today, in albeit a new form, one acceptable to a society in which legal racialized slavery presumably no longer exists. The construct of the criminal body has been sustained in the 20th and 21st century the way it was sustained in post-emancipation America, through the racially biased laws of stand your ground culture. One researcher put it this way, so ubiquitous is the pattern of discriminatory law enforcement that the effect has been to criminalize an entire black population. Again, quoting Michelle Alexander, is called the prison industrial complex the new Jim Crow. She is right in the sense that it does, as she says, function as a well-designed system of racialized social control in a manner strikingly similar to Jim Crow. The laws that have been generated to ensure a majority black imprisoned population certainly are updated versions of Jim Crow laws. Nevertheless, the prison industrial complex is about more than the Jim Crow laws that make it work. This complex attempts to reinstall in a more acceptable 21st century manner the same system that Jim Crow was developed to reinstate. The prison industrial complex harkens back to slavery. It maintains the narrative of slavery that the black body is meant not to be free. It returns the black body back to a chattel space. It virtually re-enslaves the black body by putting it behind bars. If the black criminal is the new chattel, the industrial prison complex is the new slavocracy. The industrial prison complex is the institutional manifestation of black space in a way that seems reasonable and unbiased. With jails and prisons serving as the new plantations, cherished white property is protected, and the most dangerous black body, that is the black male body, is adequately patrolled. What makes the transformation complete is the insinuation of the image of the black body as criminal into the American collective consciousness. When this is done, the black body and the criminal body become virtually synonymous. To see a black male is to see a criminal body. While the scientific and religious community provided the evidence to sustain the notion of the black body as chattel during the 19th century, today the mass news media has provided the evidence to sustain the black male body of scientific racism. It is subtly but firmly implanted within the American psyche the notion that criminals are blacks and blacks are criminals. News media has all but taken up the mantle of phrenology, physiognomy, and other alleged evidentiary science. It has become the progenitors of scientific racism. It is subtly but firmly implanted within the American psyche the notion that criminals are blacks and blacks are criminals. Many scholars and researchers have reached a similar conclusion after studying the news media's coverage of crime. They have variously concluded, as a result of the overwhelming media focus on crime, drug use, gang violence, and other forms of antisocial behavior among African Americans, the media has fostered a distorted in public perception, a distorted public perception of African Americans. Moreover, there are numerous studies that reveal almost automatic unconscious responses to black bodies, as if those bodies are threatening or criminal in and of themselves. Alexander concludes that blackness and crime has become so conflated in the public consciousness that the construct of the criminal black man is an inevitable reality. While much focus has been on black male bodies, it is not just about black males. Black female bodies have not been exempt from stereotypic characterizations and racialized violence. The black female body has been criminalized as well, perhaps in a more gender-specific way. While not regularly portrayed as particularly predatory, she is often portrayed as criminally immoral. The Jezebel has morphed into the welfare queen. Various studies have shown that the image of the black female welfare offender is just as implanted within the public consciousness as the criminal black male. Moreover, the portrait that Daniel P. Moynihan painted of black women some 50 years ago lingers in the American imagination, that being breeders of the tangle of black criminal pathology. But most significantly, black women have been caricatured as mean and angry. It is telling that the black female image that looped most in the media during the Baltimore protests was of a black mother hitting her son, outraged by his participation in the street violence. Even as she was praised for her actions, the picture of an angry black woman was once again ingrained in the American consciousness. And who could forget the July 28, 2008 New Yorker cover of Michelle Obama and then presidential candidate Barack Obama, with Miss Obama sporting an afro, dressed in military fatigues, toting a machine gun flung across her back, held up by a holster filled with ammunition. Satire aside, the cartoonish image certainly played into the stereotype of the mean, angry black woman. The caricature of black women as angry is the female version of the criminally dangerous black man. Both stereotypes portray black people as hostile and as a threat to wider society. Both suggest people who need to be controlled. Both are applied to black bodies that are perceived as violating norms, which suggest black inferiority and white superiority, or black bodies that trespass into the white space. The transformation from chattel to criminal is complete. The free black body is viewed as a clear and present danger to cherished white property. It is a body that needs to be kept from roaming freely about society. It needs to be patrolled and controlled. This is a criminal body. It is also an unalterably guilty body. Free black bodies have to be guilty of something. In fact, according to the web of discourse and knowledge spun by America's grand narrative of Anglo-Saxon exceptionalism, they are. They are guilty of trespassing into the white space. They are guilty of betraying their divine creation. Unless controlled, as the discourses of Anglo-Saxon exceptionalism have asserted, free black bodies are bound to revert into their more savage nature and commit crime. America's exceptionalist identity is further sustained by the construction of racialized guilt, nothing less than a foil for the transgressions of whiteness. For as long as there is a black body, then the white body can maintain its essential innocence. Practically speaking, and as we have seen, a free black body does not enjoy the presumption of innocence. Thus, black murder victims like Trayvon and Jordan and Renisha are the ones put on trial. Because they are black and free, they must have been guilty of something. Michael, Tamir, James, Renisha, Jonathan, Jordan, Trayvon, and on, all are victims of America's exceptionalism's constructed reality of black guilt. They were free black bodies in a white space. It was a white space because white people occupied it. They were surely guilty of a crime. And so they were stopped, murdered, and then put on trial, even after their deaths. The discursive productions of America's narrative of exceptionalism have done their job. My son was about 2 years old. I had taken him to the park to play in a Flintstone-like car that was on the park's playground. This particular park was next door to an elementary school. After being in the park for about 15 minutes, what appeared to be a class of first graders recessed into the park. Two little boys, one blonde-haired, the other red-headed, ran down to the park where my son was playing. Seeing them coming, my son immediately jumped out of the car. Soon, the two little boys began fighting over who was going to play in the car. My son looked on with the fascination of a two-year-old. The little red-headed boy, who seemed to be winning the battle for the car, saw my son looking on. He suddenly stopped fighting for the car and turned toward my son. Then, with all the venom that a 7 or 8 year old boy could muster, he pointed his finger at my son and said, "You better stop looking at us before I put you in jail where you belong." This little boy was angry, My son had intruded upon his space. My son was guilty of being black in the park and looking. I was horrified. Before I could say anything to the offending boy, the white teacher who was in earshot approached. She clearly heard what the little boy said to my son. I expected her to admonish the little boy and to make him apologize. Instead, she looked at my two-year-old son as if he were the perpetrator of some crime and said to the little boys, "Come on with me before there is trouble." At that moment, I was seething with anger. I took my son and left the park. As I was driving home, tears flowed from my eyes. I felt an unspeakable sadness and pain. At 2 years old, my son was already viewed as a criminal. At 7 or 8 years old, the link between a black body and a criminal body had already been forged in the mind of a little white boy. If at 2 years old, my son was regarded as guilty of something by the white teacher, I feared what his future would bring as he got older. If at two, looking like a guilty criminal got a finger pointed in his face and a teacher hustling kids off to safety, what will the response be to him now that he is a proud 6'22" man? Unfortunately, I know that response. Today, Stand Your Ground culture is fueled by the presence of a black man living in the White House. There is no greater challenge to America's grand narrative of Anglo-Saxon exceptionalism than a black president. This represents a complete encroachment upon the space reserved for cherished white property. It is no surprise, therefore, that Stand Your Ground culture has asserted itself in an aggressive and unrelenting manner. All of the weapons that have been used over time have been brought to bear in the current climate of Stand Your Ground culture. The stop and frisk laws, which are disproportionately applied to black and brown bodies, harken back to the black code vagrancy laws. Once again, you can be stopped and arrested for living black. The dismantling of the 1965 Voters' Rights Act, as well as racialized gerrymandering, is reminiscent of the white backlash that followed Reconstruction, again the first time that black people ascended into the white political space. Again, most troubling of all, the Stand Your Ground laws, in conjunction with the conceal and carry gun laws, and in some states, such as Ohio, open carry laws, have made legal a murderous act that was extra legal, that is, lynching. What is happening to our black children? They are falling victims to the 21st century version of Stand Your Ground culture. The senseless murders of the Trayvons, Jordans, Renishas, and Jonathans are the result of events that have unfolded over a number of centuries. The deaths of these young black people are about a culture that is bound and determined to protect the Anglo-Saxon white country that founding fathers like Thomas Jefferson imagined and worked to build. And so it is that this country faces once again a moment of crisis concerning the kind of nation it intends to be. Prior to his election, in a speech before the Illinois Republican State Convention, Abraham Lincoln warned the nation that it could not survive, he said, half slave and half free. He continued his theme into his second inaugural address when he recognized that the issue of slavery had the power to destroy the nation. Some 100 years later, in the wake of the increasing violent and hateful resistance to black people's demands for their civil rights, on June 11, 1963, John Kennedy delivered perhaps his most significant speech on race in America. Calling civil rights for black Americans a moral issue, he recognized the way in which the legacy of slavery continued to shape race relations in America. He said, 100 years of delay have passed since President Lincoln freed the slaves, yet their heirs, their grandchildren, are not fully free. They are not yet freed, he said, from the bonds of injustices. They are not yet freed from social and economic oppression. And this nation, for all of its hopes and all of its boasts, will not be free until all of its citizens are free, end quote. So now, here we are, more than 150 years after Lincoln, and more than 50 years after Kennedy, with the same questions. Du Bois' poignant description of the divided soul of the black American also aptly describes America itself. In the words of Du Bois, America is a nation defined by two thoughts, two warring ideas. Is the nation, this nation, striving to be a slave nation or a free nation? Is it to be a nation defined by the sin of Anglo-Saxon exceptionalism, nor by a commitment to justice and freedom for all? In this moment of stand your ground cultural realities, the answer to that question has yet to be determined. Thank you.
Why don't we take some time and see if you have responses you would like to share? There's a mic coming. You might stand and speak into the mic.
Thank you very much. Comment and tell me how much of an oversimplification this might be, and I'm sure it is, that a large majority of people in this country view the world in two distinct classes. One is those who work hard to make what they need to make to survive and to do well. And the other class are those who mooch off the people that work hard and do well. And that it tends to be the first group has European descent and the second tends to be minorities. Make a comment about that. Is that too simple?
Oh, that's a part of the narrative of Anglo-Saxon exceptionalism, and it's a narrative that has been legitimated by the Protestant work ethic, right? And so it's all part and parcel of the same piece that makes this whole notion and of Anglo-Saxon exceptionalism ingrained within America's collective consciousness. And what it serves to do is mystify the realities, the real systemic and structural realities of oppression and racial injustice in this country. Yes.
Thank you for a very stimulating talk. I was particularly struck by your idea of Anglo-Saxon chauvinism. I grew up in a family, my father grew up before World War I, and he was very definitely an Anglo-Saxon chauvinist, and he applied his chauvinism against Irish, Italian, Jews, and yet those divisions are no longer an issue, basically, but we still have this issue of color. Could you comment on how that has evolved?
Yes. It is, in fact, the case that this narrative of Anglo-Saxon exceptionalism and indeed the stand your ground culture that it spawned enacted itself initially, not simply in regards to the black body in terms of slavery, but really began to enact itself in regards to those white persons or those Europeans who were not in Anglo-Saxons, those who came from Southern Europe as opposed to Northern and Eastern Europe. And so you did indeed see this prejudice, this culture of oppression, subjugation, and marginalization, and all of marginalization enact itself against Italians, Irish, et cetera, et cetera. But, and you saw quota laws, right? You had someone like, for instance, Ben Franklin, as early as Ben Franklin, worried about the Germans that were pouring in to Pennsylvania. You had people making demands. This whole issue of language is nothing new. It's a part of this whole stand your ground culture. Making demands that people had to speak English. You know, Thomas Jefferson wouldn't have minded if they spoke Anglo-Saxon, but that they had to speak English. Finding ways to make clear or to protect Anglo-Saxon heritage. You had quota systems. You had presidents such as Teddy Roosevelt worried, actually demanding that Anglo-Saxon women bear children, and a whole lot of them, to protect themselves and to protect the country from the corruption of these influences that were coming in from Europe, these immigrants that were coming in that were in fact not Anglo-Saxon. But here's, and so there's a long history of that, and a lot of laws, Woodrow Wilson, this goes all down through our history. But there was a belief that they could indeed, in fact, I believe it was Theodore Roosevelt who said that perhaps within two or three generations, they can become assimilated enough that they can become adopted Anglo-Saxons. Because there was one thing that they had that black people didn't have. And of course, what was that? Whiteness. They were white. And in fact, they said, but I'm white, but I'm white. And so, indeed, that's how whiteness and what I talk about, the emergence of cherished white property and white supremacy, that's when it begins to emerge as this dividing line. And so if you are white, you're Anglo-Saxon enough. Again, so as long as you assimilate into Anglo-Saxon, as they would say, social usages and customs. And so you are indeed right. Now, the other interesting thing before I leave this point is that they were very clear. The Irish and the Italians and the others that would flood in from Western and Southern Europe, they were very clear that they weren't black. And so they wanted to draw the line between who they were and who black people were. And so they proclaimed again their whiteness. They might not have had Anglo-Saxon blood, but they had white skin. And so that's how it began to emerge as a marker. And there are Supreme Court cases that indeed, for instance, there was a case, I can't remember the exact year or date, but there was a case where an Asian man by the name of Thin, Asian Indian, said that he was Aryan, in fact, and that he was from the race of Caucasians. And so he wanted to have the full rights of Anglo-Saxons, but the Supreme Court ruled, no, because we have to judge by the way other people see you. And they don't see you as white. And so again, this reified the notion that whiteness becomes the dividing line. It becomes the line of protection of the Anglo-Saxon space. I think this woman right, you had right here.
The rapid gentrification of our large cities, Washington, D.C., New York, San Francisco, is now giving way to a take your ground culture where people are being rapidly dispossessed. I wonder if you could comment on that.
Well, this is nothing new, and it's still staying your ground, or you can call it take your ground, but people, that's their space. And so they're coming back to reclaim what is supposed to be their space. This is a part of the long history, and we can talk about programs of redlining that were actually legal and put in place, where red line was drawn around the map of where loans would be given or not given to black people. And what this has created is this kind of impoverished urban center. It's created this large wealth gap in the between the black and white community. It's created this disproportionate, this grave black underclass and what Eugene Robinson, a journalist, calls the abandoned class. And so what's happening, of course, is first you have the move into the suburbs and then the move back. And when they move back, then they push blacks either out or further in to even a smaller pocket. So you see it both ways happening in Maryland, particularly where I live. It's pushing black people out. In Washington, D.C., it's pushing them in to an even smaller space, and it's making it impossible for them to live there because, of course, the moment white people move in, put a little, put a plant on their porch, and then the property values go up, and nobody can afford to live there except them. So it's a part of the same piece of the puzzle.
I'll ask a quick, so I so appreciate the way in which the conversation about Anglo-Saxon superiority then gets contorted even more under the conditions of chattel slavery. And I so often hear in contemporary conversations the word slavery has almost become like a soft word for a system that lasted 200 years and was probably the most brutal system the world has ever seen of torturing and extracting labor from bodies. And in the image of Stand Your Ground, as I was listening to you today, for the first time, it occurred to me, under the conditions of slavery, black bodies were the ground. Mm-hmm. I mean, they were the thing that needed to be stood upon. They became, I mean, their bodies became the ground that you stand on. So I wonder if you can just, you know, talk about this relationship between land, yeah, labor exploitation, bodies, and this whole notion that you have a ground that you own.
Yeah, well, yes, black bodies were property. One of the things that I always, when I talk about slavery in the United States, I always describe it as chattel slavery, because it was unique in that regard. It was different from the slavery that was experienced in the ancient world. And it was also different from the slavery that was experienced in Africa, even at the time of chattel slavery. Because this slavery in this country tried to disconnect a people from their humanity. It literally said that they were not human. They were property. And so they were the property of white America, of white people. So they had no rights as human beings because they weren't human beings. They were property. And so what we see is that, so they were disconnected from their humanity. And so what we see is that this notion continues to linger, right? That black people are not human, that they are chattel. And so that's the first distinction that I always try to make clear. And so that we understand that the reality of what the reality of slavery was like in America. And so you're right in the sense that they're the ground, they're the property, right, to which people can do whatever they want to do with. Now, the irony is that in some respects, as they were cherished property in that regard, they had more protection as property than they did after they were no longer property, because, of course, they were valued. And so they had some, quote unquote, sense of protection, if one wants to call it that. So that's, yeah, that lingers, and that's why we always have to remember that black people in this country were not introduced as a population into this country as human beings.
You have spoken powerfully and forcefully, and you have spoken the truth. And it is very difficult to hear. I have, it's the truth, And it's not difficult to hear intellectually, but emotionally, personally for me, all of my adult life, which is now over 50 years, I have desired for African Americans to be treated justly and fairly in this country. And it is not happening. 20 years ago, in the 90s, worked on that issue a good bit in the presbytery where I was a member after race riots in the New York City area. National Council of Churches said to all of the denominations, racism is still alive and well in spite of all the work 30 years ago with Dr. King. Every presbytery, then our denomination said, every presbytery, do something about this. Our presbytery modeled after National Capital. I'm in Delaware, Newcastle Presbytery. We worked on developing a 50-hour program, which we ran for about six Saturdays. We were trained by diversity trainers. We had African and black and white participants to look at life history and how we, especially the white folk, how they learned that blacks were inferior, which comes with mother's milk in America. It's part of our culture, and it is still here, and President Obama said it correctly. America's original sin is still with us. The African Americans in the group would talk about how they learned that they were inferior and what that did to their psyche. And there were many tears that were shed in our formation group, and then we tried to take this message. We maybe reached 1,000 people out of a presbytery of 10,000. So my question today is, what can we do? I heard the leaders of DeRay McKesson and his female counterpart, Eliza, last name I won't pull right now, at the University of Delaware about 10 days ago. And as I listened to them, their message was that to work on this issue, they were saying, we want African Americans to be treated like you treat anybody else. You call them by their first name, or Mr. or Mrs., depending on their rank or status or condition, or whatever, their reverend or doctor, or whatever they may be, but they're just to be like the rest, like everybody else. And I like that concept. However, I wondered, what do we need to do? How can we get a handle on it? Does it all have to be individual transformation? That's my question.
Well, it's a big question. I will speak a little more to that question on tomorrow, but in broad strokes, to be sure, there has to be transformations and dismantlings on all levels of society. And so one of the things that we cannot ignore, and probably our first priority until the hearts and minds of people catch up. So if they don't catch up, fine. But we need to create a society, sort of, as I always say, as if God's justice is present, which means that we need to begin to dismantle these systems and structures of violence, of racialized injustice. These systems and structures that guarantee that a disproportionate number of the black population are in not just poverty, but abject poverty. We need to, these systems and structures that place brown and black children, and I'm speaking a little more to what I'll speak to tomorrow, but that place brown and black children in schools in which two-thirds of the schools in which brown and black children are a part of, or that brown and black children attend, two-thirds of those schools don't teach algebra and don't teach chemistry. And so which means that these kids obviously can't move forward. These kinds of educational, economic, health systems and structures are tinged, are infiltrated, defined by racialized injustice. And those need to be called out, named, and changed. We have to do more in that regard than just treat black people and brown people like everybody else. No. We've got to, we aren't talking about equality, we're talking about equity. Which means that we have to make up the ground, right? Because equality won't get us there. And so we have to start talking about what does it take for us to be a more equitable society. And so it's in broad strokes. It takes a lot of work, and it takes people also giving up their entitlement to privilege, right? And recognizing that they have what they have because somebody else doesn't have what they need to have.
I see there are a couple other hands up. If you're okay,
let's take
maybe two or three more. Tom?
I can speak loud enough.
No, you need to be in the mic. So
weird. Oh, I'm sorry. Okay. The tendency for light-skinned blacks to be treated differently than those who are very black. It seems like, you know, in the media and so on, TV, etc., they're more readily accepted. So I'd like your comment about that. Also, when I was a campus minister, I found that it was easier to find places for international students who were black to locate in the community if they were told they were international students rather than American blacks.
Yeah, that's the way white racism works. Again, a part of that in terms of is standards. The norms, whatever those norms are in this country, norms of beauty, norms of language and culture, all of those things are white norms. And that which is considered American, right? To be American is to be white. As Toni Morrison says, behind what it means to be American, there's always the other, which is the black other, right? And so that which you point to is part and parcel of the manifestations of this ideology in this country that defines really what it means to be an American, which means that the non-white body is never an accepted American body. And we see this rhetoric, this lethal rhetoric continue to replay itself over and over and over again. And we see, of course, we see it playing itself out again in the presidential election and debates as they come up, as we once again are talking about who are the acceptable and unacceptable immigrants in this country.
Let me hand.
Thank you for your very perceptive and persuasive presentation, prophetic presentation. How do you account for the fact, given the truth of what you said, that America has elected once and twice a black man to the highest office in this country, a leading contender, the other political party, is a black man?
I won't speak to the leading contender in the other political party, except to say this, that blackness in this regard and this culture also has to mean more than something about what more than just what you look like and what you happen to look like. And it has also to do with the values and the commitments that you maintain, right? And so that's what I'll say about the leading contender, because it doesn't, some people can, don't make white America feel uncomfortable. And will help to sustain the status quo of Anglo-Saxon exceptionalism. As for President Obama, well, America's reverberating over that, isn't it? As I said, this current hostile and most aggressive manifestation of stand your ground culture, I declare, has a lot to do with that black man being in the White House. And certainly the responses that he has received since he's been in the White House. America is very aware that a black man is in the White House. Who else from the Senate floor will call the President of the United States a liar? If President Obama said the sky was blue, there would be an act on the House of Congress to say he was wrong. So we have to look at how the country has responded to his presence in the White House as well, and what has happened to this country. And of course, it's a part again of masquerading and mystifying the reality of racism and white supremacy in this country when you hear people like Rupert Murdoch and others say, well, it's under President Obama's watch that Black Lives Matter movement has occurred, and under President Obama's watch that all of these black lives of black people have been killed, and so on and so on, as if it's President Obama's fault and not a reflection of the intrinsic ideology and systems and structures of white supremacy in this country. And so that America happened to elect, by the way, black Americans had a whole lot to do with that, put President Obama into the White House is not a suggestion in the least that we live in a post-racial society. In fact, his presence in the White House has made clear that we do not, and it has unearthed what is always this underlying narrative in this country in a most virulent way. And, maybe when he's no longer in the White House, white America will take their foot off the pedal a little bit and give black lives a break.
Kelly, in your work, you have written so powerfully not only about race politics in this country, but about gender politics and around sexuality. Could you make a few comments about how you're thinking about white supremacist culture and stand your ground ideology is also informing struggles around gender, sexuality, and including reproductive self-determination? Anything you might say about that?
Just a little question.
In a sound bite?
Sound bite. Well, you know what? One thing about this culture, first of all, they are all part of the same piece. We have to talk about these sort of interlocking realities of oppression. We're talking about racialized, patriarchal, heteropatriarchal oppression, right? One thing that is common is that these constructs of oppression function in a kind of dualistic, oppositional manner, either or. And so when we think of gender, we think of male or female. When we think of sexual orientation, we think of hetero or non-hetero, right? Black or white. And so there's always something that's in opposition. There's always something that's other. Now, here's the thing when I think of particularly gender and gender identities and sexual orientations. This binary is wrong, simply put. Human beings, the human creation is not a binary creation. There's, when I hear about transgender realities, it's like, no, it's not transgender. This is the gender they are. right? And so we've got it wrong. It's not about male, female. There are other cultures that have long since recognized more than two genders. And so, and again, you know, it's long since been recognized that there are complex and richly complex and diverse ways in which people understand not simply their gender, but their sexual orientation. And those are two different things. And so I think that we are just, one of the things that is common is that this is a culture that always others, that is an oppositional culture, that there's always, and it thinks in terms of binaries. And if, when we think in terms of binaries, someone's always on the outside looking in.
I think we'll let our speaker close off, but let me just remind you that tomorrow morning we have an opportunity to hear her second plenary address, where she'll speak about Stand Your Ground and the Justice of God. And I believe that is at 10. I'm just checking to make sure I'm right. 10 o'clock tomorrow morning. Let's express our appreciation for Kelly's presentation today.
Thank you.